Good morning, good evening, or afternoon, depending on what side of the pond you're on, and welcome to an extra special episode of Across the Pitch. My name is Phil Kennedy, and I'm joined by Arran and Matt Robards tonight, where we have an extra special guest who, in my mind, is a preeminent voice in Phoenix Rising Nation. We have none other than Owain Evans on the line, and this is a guy that if you want to know something about Phoenix Rising, this is the man to ask. Welcome to the show. It's an honor to have you on today.
Well, thanks for having me, guys. It's fun to be on as well.
Now, for those of you that haven't heard that accent before, that is a proper Welsh accent, isn't it? Where and why are you here?
So I first moved to Tempe. I must have been 16 at the time. And it's because of my dad moving over for work. And although I went back for a while at university, I then ended up coming back over here again to do my master's degree at ASU. And I've been covering the team since.
Right. Whereabouts would you call home in Wales?
So I'm from Barry, which will be familiar to people who are aware of a TV show by the BBC called Gavin and Stacey. Probably not to many people over here. Yeah. for those who aren't quite aware of where that is, it's not too far away from Cardiff, so it's in South Wales. It's about 20 minutes away from Cardiff.
So is that the team that you support over in Wales, is Cardiff?
Oh, yes. not a great choice at times, but...
I suppose it's only fair. We had a Swansea fan on the other week, so we like to make it balanced here on the show.
Well, it's evidence that clearly I could have made worse life choices.
So, like you mentioned, you came over here and you got your master's degree, and that was with ASU, and you were involved with the Cronkite School over there, right?
Yeah, I was. So I did a master's in sports journalism, and then as part of that, so initially I was interning with a team, so I used to be behind. Have you ever used to watch the Insta stories from the team? During games, I used to do a lot of that. And then as time went on with the master's degree and I moved into the newsroom at Cronkite, I started covering the team journalistically instead, in addition to some of the fun things like how about a year ago, if you'd have turned PBS on a Tuesday night, you'd have seen me on there, which is a bit of a surprise from my perspective. I'm not much of a broadcaster, but it was an interesting experience.
Well, you say you're not much of a broadcaster, but honestly, you're probably the person with the most rising knowledge besides Coach Chance. How did that come about?
I mean, at the end of the day, I mean, a lot of it started back when I started covering the team, really, and that is because, you know, initially the club never had any regular like media time or anything. Everything was very ad hoc, and because essentially I bugged and bugged and bugged and bugged and bugged Jose until the club started offering availability on a Tuesday. And so I would go along every Tuesday, and a lot of the time I was the only one there. It would be the middle of summer. The sun was beating down on me, and I'd stand there in the middle, in the heat for an hour. And, I definitely got quite red as a result. But at the end of the day, then I was speaking with the players at least once a week, and more people ended up catching on. You know, it's good to see that there is a bigger expansion of the coverage since that point. But, you know, for a lot of last season, I was one of the few people going there every week and chatting to Rick and the players and just getting some extra info that otherwise wouldn't really be out there.
That's something impressive. I've been incredibly impressed with is the amount of time and And I've tried to make it out there when I can, and started getting on some of the coaches' calls and things like that. And you know, I have never not seen you there. So, you know, just your commitment to, you know, like you said, and it gleaning any piece of knowledge about the team that you can, it's really, it makes it so much easier for us, because, you know, when we're doing a Phoenix Rising podcast, we can kind of go and start looking through your Twitter and see what you've been posting, because you post all the videos from the coaches' calls, all the videos from the interviews after the game, and just we're so thankful that you put out all the content out there for us to have as fans and as you know, fellow media coverage.
I'd never say we'd steal content, but gee, you're good.
Well, it's not stealing, is it? It's once it's out there, it's out there. And you know, at the end of the day, I suppose as a journalist, what do you want? You want to get the stuff out there, and you want to be leading those conversations. So I'm glad you guys do pick up on it.
So now you're pretty spot on with a lot of stuff I've noticed. One thing that caught my eye today was Rick Shantz was talking about, the coach Rick Shantz was talking about the possibility of points per game. I'm going to ask you to describe what that means in 1 second, but you also called him back and you said he was wrong. Did you double check that before you tweeted?
Yeah, so what I did is I put out his quote first, and then I thought, how does that add up? And so I went on the USL website and just chucked the numbers into my phone. And I was like, hang on a minute. No, they've been second. Because, I mean, obviously, Los Dos have been phenomenal this season, apart from when they showed up here. They've not played that many games, but they've won everything except when they came here. So they'd be above, but I thought surely the others aren't doing that well. It turns out they're not.
All right. So can we do a bit of a dive into that? So for those of you that aren't following over here too closely, the season has been truncated. It's been broken up into, what have we got, six groups? Seven groups? I can't remember.
Eight
groups. There we go.
Four in each conference.
I was getting there. And basically play within that conference, although we didn't last week. We thumped New Mexico United, which is great fun. But basically, the specter of COVID-19, and I guess the specter of, points per game, which was really, really not well-liked, shall we say, over in the English leagues when that was put into practice over there. That was raised as well. So there's a good – explain this to us, please.
so essentially, it's essentially what it says on the tin. It's points per game. You just take the number of points and you're dividing it by the number of games. I mean, it was, from my perspective as I look at it, I don't see it as being as controversial here as it was in England. And the reason for that is that the way the English leagues are set up is, you know, you play everybody twice, once home, once away. It's a completely balanced schedule. That just isn't the case here. And so the inherent unfairness with points per game is obviously that it's unbalanced, but everything's already unbalanced over here. So I'm not sure it's quite the same
problem. I think there's two other factors. Is one, here, nobody's getting relegated over it. And the other is that over there, it wasn't something that came up until the season was already started, where here, the USL already kind of agreed to it before they went into this 16-game group stage. So they kind of knew that it was there before they even started, if you will.
Yeah, because, I mean, the way it went back in the English leagues was essentially you were making a decision on whether you're going to go to points per game, knowing exactly, as a result, who was going to be in the playoffs, who was going to get promoted, and who was going to get relegated.
Right.
You know, it was a decision made that ultimately was, are we happy with where the table sits now and we'll just pack it in? Or are we going to actually try and fix this? So, yeah, the timing as well is just, it's a huge factor, I think, for why it was so controversial.
Right.
Now, Arran had said that, you're a leader of conversation among Phoenix Rising fans. That got me thinking to a conversation that you had started last week that it was a Twitter poll that it ended in a dead heat for the Phoenix Rising's biggest rival between Orange County and New Mexico. What were your thoughts on that finishing in a dead heat like that? And did it surprise you?
I mean, it did surprise me a bit. And I think, if I'm going to be honest, I think that the reaction to this last weekend and the reaction that we saw coming out of the game on Saturday from players and fans kind of shows that really you can say Orange County because it makes sense, there's history, but I don't think they really are. I think that the animosity from the fans is all towards New Mexico. I mean, the kind of stuff that was coming out after the Orange County games when the team played poorly, there was a lot of disappointment that Rising had lost or drawn and that they performed very badly, to be honest, in both of those games. But it wasn't disappointment about the fact that they played badly against Orange County. And I just think that as a whole, you know, the way that the fans reacted to that win against New Mexico felt almost like, I mean, you referenced it earlier with Swansea, you know, it felt like as a Cardiff fan when you get one over on Swansea, the reaction if they'd have lost would probably have been similar. But like normally when you lose to your biggest rival, that's the kind of thing that almost ruins a season, no matter how well it goes. It kind of ruins the season. I just didn't feel that the reaction to the Orange County game was anything like that at all.
Matt, I want to hear your thoughts on this. I have my thoughts, but you'll be very quiet over there.
Yeah, man, it's hard. You know, I'm just listening to this conversation. I don't know, man. When you talk rivals, I mean, for me personally, I think it's Orange County just because of the history, as well as it's a more balanced rivalry. You know, we've had all draws last year, three wins. You know, New Mexico did win on penalties in the U.S. Open Cup, but do you really count that? And then finally, we get an emphatic win over them at home, 5-2. That just doesn't feel that much like a rivalry for me yet. I think it's on the cusp. You know, I think you give New Mexico a couple years to really be a force in this league outside of this truncated season. Whereas last year, you know, they started off really strong and then just fell off as they went on that U.S. Open Cup run. Whereas Orange County has just been, they've been around, you know, since we've been around. Those games are always tough, especially away. You know, they have fans that travel here and sing and congregate and get into it. And it just feels more like a rivalry experience to me.
I have to agree with you, Matt. I think it's the length of the rivalry and the fact that they generally are really tough fought matches. And let's not forget that conference win that we had away over there. That's stuff that really builds rivalries. I think the New Mexico rivalry is great. It's new. I love it. I love their trash talk. And then it gets turned on their head like the next day. It's brilliant. Keep it up, New Mexico. But for me, it's Orange County.
Yeah, I mean, I think one of the factors that would maybe go in favor of New Mexico is just that they have a larger and more passionate fan base. I mean, like Matt said, Orange County does have a very hardcore group of loyal supporters, but it's just not this big vocal collective.
that's a very good point, actually, Phil. You might have swung me with that argument, honestly.
Well, I think too, it's just tough for Orange County. I mean, they're in such a saturated market anyways. You know, you got LA, LAFC. I mean, it's tough down there. And they haven't been successful in recent years. And so we all know that most fans are fair weather fans, especially when you're in a saturated market. But yeah, I mean, hands down, the fan base in New Mexico is huge. Again, you talk in what, 14,000 at one point last year at a game.
Yeah.
I mean, that's no small feat. But again, I think you give New Mexico just a couple more years to kind of establish themselves in this league. And I could see them surpassing Orange County in that regard, as far as our main rival.
Yeah, I mean, I think that both teams are going to be rivals coming down the road. I think that in the United States, I mean, you know, one thing that we've talked about in England so much is you have, you know, like Arsenal and Spurs are 4 miles away, or you know, even, you know, Liverpool and Everton are a mile away. Well, when you come to Phoenix, I believe Las Vegas at 282 miles is our shortest trip. And, you know, they just really haven't been relevant. So then you have, you know, Orange County and New Mexico that are both about, you know, a 6-8 hour drive away are our next closest ones. But one thing I'm interested in is the team that we have coming up, which is actually closer to us than either of those, an expansion team this year, and that's San Diego. Owain, do you see San Diego possibly becoming our biggest rival down the road? Do you think that's something you can see building up?
I think it's something that is very awkward to judge at this moment, and the reason for that is with New Mexico, you could see immediately that they were, you know, they had the fan base there. With Orange County, as you say, it's all the history, the fact that these teams are playing each other from the days of the Blues playing against the Wolves. But for San Diego, you know, they've launched in a pandemic year where for the majority of games they can't have fans there. And I'd imagine that is stunting their growth a little bit. And it's just a very strange year. I mean, it could be that a few years down the line, maybe it does blossom into something, but it's just far too early now. And with the circumstances that there are, that you just can't put all the pieces together or even see where they're starting to come together, because it's just, you know, all those aspects just aren't there.
Do you think it's probably a good thing that the fans weren't there? Like, wouldn't you be a little bit sheepish to turn up if you were called the locals? No, that one, you didn't like that one? That's got to be the worst name for a supporter base, hasn't it? Yeah, we're locals. It sounds like they're the bullies on the beach. Do you know what I mean? Or am I just like completely wrong with this and you love the name?
Nah, I agree with you, man. I agree with you. The San Diego thing I find so interesting. You know, like Owain said, I mean, launching in this pandemic year, which they didn't obviously see coming. And then, you know, you not only are, we're launching, you know, in this new market, this market that's now devoid of professional sports because, you know, the Chargers packed up and went north. Or I guess they still have the Padres. I don't follow baseball at all.
Yeah, they got the Padres, but they're not good.
You know, and then you bring in a guy like Landon Donovan, you know, U.S. men's national team legend, one of the best players the U.S. has ever produced. And you have all this hype going, and now there's this launch. And you can't have fans there. It's tough. You know, and we talked about it leading up to this season, man. I'm excited for San Diego to hopefully become maybe that rivalry. But either way, an away day to San Diego is a lot better to me than an away day to Vegas or Albuquerque.
Albuquerque, I know.
So I'm down with San Diego.
Hey, you got some nice Hatch chili peppers at Albuquerque.
I guess you could go on like a Breaking Bad tour when you get there.
Yeah, I've done that. It's worth doing the Breaking Bad tour, but you only do that once, you know.
I hear you can get a fun tour of the locker room as well if you time it right.
Shout out to Phantom West. How you doing, mate?
So speaking of San Diego, like we mentioned, that was the upcoming match. One of the things that Coach Schultz brought up on the call today is that San Diego might be the best defensive team that we've played so far. So kind of tactically, what are you looking at Phoenix Rising to do in that match to kind of break down this solid defense of San Diego?
Well, I think that, and it's something that Rick said in the call today, because San Diego play with that central three at the back, and then they focus more on having the wing backs as well. You've got to look to try and use the wingers effectively going forward. I think the concern from Rising's point of view is going to be the fact that at the end of the day, nobody beats Rising by trying to play the Phoenix Rising way. Nobody comes and says, we're about to play Phoenix. Oh, it's okay. They can score 3, we'll score 4. because Rising play that way and they will mop the floor with you. What you have to do is you have to sit back and you have to frustrate Phoenix. And so that is almost the concern for Rising going into this, is that if they struggle to get anything going forward, you're going to see Rising push further and further up, and you may well see them get caught on a break like they did against Orange County.
So I want to ask you about that, because the starting lineup for Phoenix Rising last week, Rick Shantz showed New Mexico United quite a bit of respect with that starting lineup. It was a 5-4-1. Now, I don't think we've started with a 5-4-1, have we? I've got his team sheet right in front of me right now, and he started.
I'm gonna hop in there and say that if you look at Rising's team sheet every game, they randomly draw a 5-4-1 on there. It's I don't understand it. I don't get it. But every single one that I've got, it doesn't matter how they're playing. You know, they could have a team of junior Flemings alone out there, and Rick would still draw a little 5-4-1 in that tactical thing at the bottom.
Okay. All right. Thank you. That was immediate new mistake right there. Thank you for pointing that out.
Well, one thing on the team sheet that I noticed, and this was something that came up on the call today also, and it's something that we had kind of been discussing among ourselves, has been Joey Calistri. And him coming in at right back a couple of times, subbing on. And today on the coach's call, Coach Schatz really was talking about Calistri is a guy that can play three positions. He can play forward, he can play mid, he can play defense. Last year, I really saw him as mostly only kind of a forward or a winger. Were you surprised to see him on the back line, or is this something that you kind of already knew he did?
It was a bit of a surprise, but at the end of the day, I can see why they'd look to try and repurpose him a little bit, because he's at the moment behind Junior, Santi, and Solo, and you know, being the fourth man after those that's not going to be fun. I mean, if you want to throw someone else in the mix as well, Lagos can also play on the wing. In fact, when I spoke to him last week, he said, you know, he actually feels more comfortable on the wing because it's a position that he's played in for most of his career than he does as the backup striker up front, because that's something that's completely new to him playing as this center forward. So it's not, I suppose, entirely surprising they pushed him back. And it's not surprising when you think about Rick's playing style either, because he's always so keen for his fullbacks to push forward. And we saw it a lot last year. You know, Amadou Dia pushed forward all the time. And I mean, Mustafa had pace to burn. You know, this season, he actually complained after the first Orange County game. And he said in the press conference, you know, he was a bit disappointed because he didn't feel that Darnell and Contor were going forward enough. And so it's probably not that surprising when you think all those things through that he'll just try and push him back. The question is Joey capable of doing the defensive aspect of that? Because we know that he can attack from deep. Can he put in the work at the defensive end? I don't think we saw enough of that really in the last game to know. I think it'll take us a little while to get an idea if he really is comfortable back there. I mean, he did pick up a card in his bench appearance last week, but I guess it's something we'll see.
He looked a little bit out of pace there. I thought, honestly, like there was a couple of times where he got, well, run around, you know, he got stood up. I was like, that's interesting.
I know that Matt had mentioned some things about this, and I definitely want to hear what you have to say on Matt on Calistri, but I just wanted to say I had two takeaways for watching Calistri play at right back. One was that, like Arran said, he just seemed to maybe struggle a little bit with where his positioning would be, where you could kind of see that he was looking around on the field to make sure he was in the right spot sometimes, I thought. But on the encouraging side, I saw him play some nice long passes up the right side to Junior Fleming. Sure. Not long balls, but long, nice passes. So I think that definitely from an attacking aspect, like you said, and especially being able to push up forward for the wingers, he's going to be really good at that. And I think that he probably has the capability to play defense. It's just going to be a matter of him getting used to playing that position, knowing where he needs to be at the formation.
Yeah, I think you nailed it, man. You know, kind of piggybacking on what you and Owen just both said, if Shantz's goal is for those outside backs to get forward a lot, and he wants them pushing forward, he wants them in the attack, having a guy like Calistri on the right who has that attacking prowess to get forward and whip in crosses and take defenders one-on-one, that might be the payoff. And the thing you're willing to take the risk on is him maybe not being as strong in one-on-one defending. You know, he did get burned a couple of times this past Saturday, or getting beat on a long ball over the top. And you have to weigh those things. Is this better for us going forward? And then we kind of risk this at the back. And you know, I work with the center backs to say, let's do better at maybe providing some coverage, you know, talking with the midfielder about, you know, when Calistri goes forward, just drop in a little bit, whatever it is, to say, let's get that attacking ability up there. I want my fullbacks up in the attack. And then we'll deal with the defensive turnovers as teams look to break on the counter. And that's just with the options. You know, when you're a manager, you just have to weigh. Those are the risks you take. Just to go along with that, I thought he did all right coming in. I think it's just a newer position. And so it's going to take him some time to develop that one-on-one defending. And I'm going to liken it to this other player, but I'm not saying Calistri's on his level. And that's not a shot, but Alphonso Davies gets sold as a forward to Bayern Munich. Bayern go through some defensive issues. They have some injuries. He drops back into that fullback position at a left back, and he struggled at first with that defensive stuff, but now he's considered maybe one of the best left backs in the world. I mean, it helps that he's playing for a team like Bayern Munich, but I could see Calistri coming along those same lines, where in a couple weeks, as he's working, you know, in practice, he's working in training with this defending, you know, when he's having to go one-on-one with guys like Flemings and Solo, who are probably the best wingers in the league. It's going to help him get better faster, and we could see him develop into this really strong attacking right back.
Yeah, I think that's a great point, Matt. I could absolutely see him developing there, and it seems like he's got a willingness to want to learn the position also. I think that, you know, you could see that he wasn't a guy that had a demeanor out there like, why is coach putting me in this position? He had a demeanor out there like, you know, he's getting ready to chew the grass off the field.
Oh, and I got a question for you, man, kind of going along the same lines of kind of Calistri stepping in this right back position. What does this mean for a guy like Austin Ledbetter or Kyle Bjornathan? Are they just kind of falling down the pecking order? Or you know, does Shantz not see any kind of value in a player like that? Or could we see them move over to FC Tucson? What are your thoughts on this depth?
Well, I think on that one, you're more looking. I think Bjornathan is more of a left back than a right back.
Right.
And I know last season when Dumbuya was out injured, what we ended up seeing instead was they shifted Corey Whelan across to play on that right back position. So I think it's more just perhaps clearing the way so that they don't have to move Corey out from the middle, because if we know one thing, it's that Rick likes the partnership between Corey Whelan and AJ Cochran in the central defensive position. So I don't think it necessarily has that much bearing on them, because I don't think it's a position they were likely to play in anyway. Does it perhaps change things up a little bit because Whelan will be in the middle, you know, not have to go out and cover at right back and open up a space in the middle, maybe? But I honestly, I'm not entirely sure it makes a huge difference to them.
One thing I just wanted to add on that Rick said in the coach's call today that I thought was important is he did make it very clear that Corey and AJ are the starting right backs.
You mean center backs?
Or that's what I meant. Center backs. I'm sorry. I was that. So they both. Well, I mean, we already knew Whelan, but But he made it very clear that he considers AJ his other starting center back. And I knew that there had been some question about that at one point.
Can we have a chat about Lagos Kunga? Now, while we were setting up for our show on Saturday down at Casino Arizona Field, we saw a very disconsolate Kunga walking really slowly from around the back of the player's entrance all the way over to the, the western sideline there and take his seat. And Kevin, well, all of us, Kevin from PRFC Fans Show and ourselves just kind of looked at him and was like, well, what's he doing? What's going on there? I mean, this is a guy, is he injured? Is he just out of sorts? Is he perhaps suffering from a little bit of MLS malaise, shall we say?
I mean, I think, and Rick mentioned this today, that it was just the way that the numbers worked out. I do wonder a little bit why they chose to bring Lagos in. And that's not a knock against him at all. But bringing him in as the the backup centre forward, as I touched on earlier, feels strange because he's not a centre forward. He is, throughout his career, he's been a winger. He has, on occasion, played, in a more central role. He did when he was with Atlanta 2, and he played as a second striker just off of Devon Sandoval, who obviously didn't play last weekend, but he is with New Mexico. And so, bringing in someone on loan who presumably, I mean, why would you send a guy out on loan unless you're expecting him to get some kind of playing time? I'm not really sure. But again, his best positions are ones that Rising is already absolutely stacked at. And so would they have been better off looking for someone who is more of a true centre forward to act as the backup for Rufat? I think they probably would have been.
Do you think that was just kind of who Atlanta wanted to give them and they were like, sure, why not?
Well, you'd hope that it wasn't quite that, because if there's one thing that I know, it's that Rick has some really good relationships because of the MLS preseason has been in Tucson, and obviously he was one of the founders of FC Tucson back in the day. He wasn't just his coach, he was one of the founders. And so he has some great relationships with coaches across MLS, and that's why Rising gets some of the guys out of LAFC. It's why they got Eric Dick. It's why they've gotten other players as well from MLS teams. And so you'd hope that he's been around the league, he knows what he's looking for, and he would have found other alternative options that could have come down. Honestly, so, I'm not entirely sure why. It happened around about the same time as the Adam Jahn deal.
I was going to say, here, we're going to buy your forward off you, and we're not going to use him, and here's a forward you can not use.
Well, they ended up using Adam John a lot because of the injury to Martinez. But yeah, I mean, I guess that's what I was kind of getting at is sometimes in a baseball trade, they have what they call a throw-in player to make the numbers work on the deal. And I'm kind of wondering if he was just like a throw-in player in the Adam John deal, if you will.
I mean, Bobby will insist that they were separate deals that were made. I'm not sure how much of that is true, how much of that is obviously, the team like to keep a lot of this close to the chest. So I can't say on that one, but I do find it a little bit strange that he's not necessarily the player that they wanted. I know Rick said that he was quite happy having two very different strikers because it gave them a little bit more unpredictability versus last season where you took Adam Jahn off and you brought Ben Spencer on. But I'm still not entirely sure what's happening. That and also, I mean, Junior has filled in as the striker a couple of times now and he seems to be scoring goals. So
yeah, just a few.
you mentioned Ben Spencer, who's a guy we might actually see this week as he went over to San Diego. What are your thoughts on Ben Spencer?
Well, what we saw of him last season, he didn't do that badly. He did manage to get a few goals. I mean, he got the brace up in Portland. He scored the goal that was ultimately the end of the game against LA Galaxy 2. He didn't realize when he hit it in the back of the net that it was going to be the end of the game, but turned out that it was. I
was rather surprised that he didn't come back. I guess is one of the things that I thought. I really liked him as a player. I don't know if Arran and Matt really agreed with me on that. So that was one of the reasons I brought it up.
We don't.
Matt, what were your overall thoughts of Ben Spencer?
I didn't think it was, I'm not surprised he didn't come back. I think at his age, you know, you're kind of 24 or 25 in the middle, you know, of kind of your prime. And he knew that he wasn't going to be the guy going forward. Especially at that point, Adam John was, you know, returning. And so he was the number nine. He was the starter. He had it coming off that great season. So he was looking for someplace else to play. Landed in San Diego, where I think he's only made a handful of appearances, if that. It was good for him to moving on. But I wouldn't say that I rated him that highly. I thought backup goalkeeper or backup striker was great, you know, if that's the role he wanted. But I think, you know, again, at that age, you're looking for more playing time. And so you're going to look elsewhere.
Yeah, I agree with what you're saying. I definitely saw him more as a backup than a starter. But I thought he was a guy that fit the system well. And like Owain was saying, you know, just kind of fit the mold of the Phoenix Rising striker. Do you think that Shots is always going to be a guy that has that big target man up front, if you will?
I mean, I think that's what he prefers, you know, and you look at who we got to replace John and Rufat and Dadashov. But we've seen, especially this year, that he's willing to kind of change that up if he needs to. And we've seen Junior kind of move into that number nine role and thrive. Yes. And, you know, Sean's has talked about how that's something they've worked on in training. And we even saw it, I think, at times last year, if I remember correctly, where you know, Solo would move up into that number nine, playing more of like a false nine. Yep. But it's something he's willing to do. I think what's surprising for me is, as well as what Owain said, is bringing in a guy like Lagos Kunga, where he's not that out and out replacement for Jean. And so, you know, it kind of, if you've replaced, you know, Dadashov late in a game, or, you know, maybe 60th, 65th, 70th minute, with a guy like Lagos Kunga, and then all of a sudden now you find yourself chasing the game, you've taken out an aerial threat at most times, where once it gets to the end, you're lobbing stuff into the box, and you see center backs going up and they're playing center forward. And so for us not to have kind of that out and out replacement for Dadashov, I think that's the weird part for me.
I have to say, Dadashov was incredibly physical. You said it on the broadcast the other night, Phil. I had the privilege of being right behind the goal as he had one of his chances. That wasn't the one that he tucked behind the net, but it was one where he could have possibly earned a penalty. This guy just plays balls to the wall. He is charging down players. He is just so incredibly physical. I like that. I think we've probably been a little bit critical of our strikers in the past, of being a little bit shy, perhaps a little bit waiting to find the perfect shot. This guy's like, I'm just taking you all on. I love that in a player. Just gives you that extra dimension. Do you know what I mean? I'm with you, Matt. I'm with you.
Yeah, I mean, I think that he's a really physical guy, and certainly he fits the mold. And Owain, I know that one of the things that Schultz has really raved about on the calls has been Dadashov's work rate. And how do you feel that Dadashov compares to the other strikers that we've had over the past few years?
Oh, well, I mean, they have been raving about his work rate a lot, and you'll hear that from Bobby if you ever talk to Bobby as well. You know, I see working rate. They love the work rate that you get out of data shop. I think it's too early still in the day, really, to compare him to people like, I mean, Adam had a great season last year. Chris Cortez has, you know, put in a great season the season before. And I do wonder if Cortez had been available, what Rising ultimately would have won in Louisville. But I think it's quite early, especially because when the team first came back from that break, he looked a little bit shaky. And you know, that's not a comment at all on his ability. You know, there were multiple parts of the team that looked a little bit shaky in those first few games back. Yeah, I know that Soto obviously gave him the penalty in the game against El Paso, and the idea behind that was to try and get his confidence up a little bit. And, you know, you hope that that's worked now, and it's why he had such a good game against New Mexico as well. But I still think it's a little bit too early, really, to say in the long run what we think Dadashov is going to do at this club.
Matt, I know you kind of said some of the exact same things.
Yeah, I mean, when you're talking about, you know, a number nine coming in, you know, I agree completely with what Owen's saying. It's early on. And this could have been a completely different conversation had this whole pandemic thing not happened. You know, at this point in the season, we could just be talking about, hey, man, he's banged in, you know, 15, 16, 17 goals already. This was a great signing. I love what I see from Dadashov. I think, you know, his work rate, his physicality, he has an awareness of where to place himself. You look at that goal that he scored this past Saturday, where the ball kind of gets deflected back out to the wing. You know, Solo makes that move. He burns another defender. He whips in that ball, and Dadashov is right there, perfectly placed to get a boot to it to redirect it into the goal. I mean, just that awareness alone is great to see from your striker. But it's a tough position to fill. We've been blessed here in Phoenix with, you know, forwards that produce and forwards that, you know, win the love of the supporters. And so I think Dadashov is on his way. He just needs to keep it up.
I agree. That's what I said. If he keeps up this form that he's doing right now and those really, really like physically threatening runs, he's going to put defenders on their asses and put the fear of God into their eyes. I think he could well become a fan favorite. I said that on the show and I backed that up tonight.
Yeah, I think that we're actually kind of seeing a little of the same trajectory that we saw with Adam Jones last year, where he came in and had a goal in the first game. And then I think maybe there was two or three games that he didn't score. I think he really just kind of started banging a bit after that. And, you know, hopefully that'll be the same thing. And, you know, so we talked a little bit earlier about some of the tactical things with San Diego. And of course, that's the upcoming game. So I think that would be a good way to wrap up our conversation, is just to kind of finish up our discussion about the San Diego game and maybe each make a prediction. So Owain, you're the guest, so you go ahead and start off and give us your breakdown of what you think is going to happen in the San Diego game and your prediction.
Well, I think it's, and I did kind of hint on this earlier, I think it's going to go one of two ways. Either Rising are going to ultimately break through the San Diego defense, probably reasonably early, let's say the first half, and the floodgates could open. Alternatively, San Diego, a far more defensive team, could sit back, absorb a lot of the pressure, and Rising, when they don't score, you can see the frustration build. And you know, that back line does push up. And the problem I think they have is that they push up and up and up, and that's something that Rick wants. But they don't really have the pace to get back. And so, well, we saw it with Orange County. If you play it up through the middle, you hit them long, you can catch this Rising team. And if you can frustrate them up at the top, then you can get a result. So I think it's going to be somewhere between Rising put four on them and win with ease, or San Diego nick a draw. And that's very fence-sitting, I know, but that's what I'm going to go with.
So Owen, let me ask you a question, man, because San Diego does have a midweek game tomorrow against Orange County, who are also in Group B. I believe they're sitting in somewhere around fourth. I don't think they're last, and I don't think they're in third. I think they're in fourth. Do you think that's going to have is that a clearly a good thing for us, you know, as we don't have a midweek game? So we get a little bit more rest. They're kind of playing midweek. Plus then they have to travel here for Saturday. Do you think that's going to play into the game at all?
I mean, I think it might, because at the end of the day, you're going to have players playing on the short rest, but equally their game on the weekend was called off. So that it's not as though they're coming in having played two games in the past week. It's still only one, even though it is a short break. They're also at home against San Diego, and I know against Orange County, sorry. And I know it's not exactly a long travel between those two anyway, but they are at home. So there's no late night after that game either. I think it could have a bearing, but I don't think it's going to have as much as it would have had if they'd have played on Saturday.
Right on.
All right. Well, here's my prediction. I'm going to say that yes, the loyal Landon Donovan's team, they're going to have a game midweek. Orange County are going to beat them up. They're going to beat them up. They're going to come over here to Phoenix. We're going to beat them up in 114 degrees or 112 degrees, whatever it's meant to be. 3-0 rising.
Well, you know, I don't think I have a lot to add, because I think the three of you really cover just about everything that I was thinking. I think that my main concern would be that San Diego is a team that's a lot like Orange County in the style of play, and that they've given us some trouble, and I could certainly see them nicking a draw out of it. But I'm going to go ahead and go with a 3-2 score in favor of the Rising myself. I think that, yeah, you know, San Diego, they're an expansion team. They haven't had that many games together. They've got the midweek game. Phoenix Rising really seemed to have kind of clicked things into place with last week's game. So I think they're going to take 3 points.
Yeah. I don't think San Diego's really played anybody. They played Las Vegas a couple times, and Las Vegas is Las Vegas. They've played Tacoma. They played the Real Monarchs, who aren't the Real Monarchs of last season because of the whole MLS's back tournament and, you know, just what all that that's being associated with being a part of an MLS setup. And then, you know, they got the draw with Sacramento, which is probably the toughest competition they faced. I think they have a tough game tomorrow against Orange County. That one probably ends in a draw or an Orange County victory. I think they come in Saturday and just get punched in the mouth personally. I'm going to say 4-0.
Bam! There it
Ooh.
Is. That's right. Unusual for you, Mr. Conservative.
That is.
I don't think I've ever heard Matt make a prediction of 4-0 before, and unless we were playing like Tacoma or something.
Yeah, I'm never the optimistic one. Now it's going to bite me in my...
Owain, it's been a pleasure to have you on the show. But before we wrap up, was there anything that we hadn't asked you about, or any information that's come out Phoenix Rising related that you think our listeners need to know?
That's a good question.
I know you've got all the details and.
I think the only comment I have left to make to the listeners is, if we can all sit there at Rising Stadium on a Saturday night wearing masks for hours in the heat, I think you can all wear your masks.
Damn, bam, there it is. On that bombshell, lads.
Well said. Arran, Matt, did you guys have anything else?
No. Good to go, buddy.
All right, well, it's been a blast, and let's hope that Phoenix Rising walk away with 3 points. And until then, up the Rising.